Drum set.
Drum set is one of the toughest instruments that you can possibly hope to record. However, when it's done right, it pays dividends tremendously. It's kind of hard to do with limited budget and limited space, but the other problem is that there's a lot of different ways to cut the cake, you know? There's more styles than just heavy metal. 13-year-old me is having an aneurysm that I ever said something like that, but we'll just roll with it, shall we? This obviously makes an introduction to the subject on YouTube, where people come to be informed, not necessarily entertained, a bit difficult because they're looking for the definitive answer, but that's exactly the last thing that I can really in good conscience give. So after thinking about it for quite a while, I decided the best course of action is the long haul. Go element by element and style by style, one by one, so that you guys can all understand it and get something really good out of it. So I guess that means I'm beginning my drum recording series. Awesome, let's start with the 70s. Hi there everyone, my name is Jake and I'm the Chief Engineer and Producer here at Sawmill Recordings, and today we're going to be talking about recording drums, obviously. So, why are we starting with the 70s? Why not the 60s or even like a modern metal thing? Well, there's a number of reasons, but the main one is 70s drums sound amazing. And if your first project is to get a good drum sound, this is the place to do it. It'll give you just enough baptism and fire to really get the idea, but also gives you the best chances for success. Sure, the sound was beaten to death back in the day, but there's been a bit of a resurgence these days, especially with acts like Foster the People and stuff. But literally, you can pull up any album, any, you know, charting album from the 70s, and you'll have a great mix. Listen to some like Toto 4, or Meatloaf, or even like the Village People on ABBA, just to be a bit corny, but still, they had great mixes and great engineers. The other reason we're starting with the 70s is that it actually doesn't take a lot of gear these days to get this sound. Notice I said gear these days. People were using stuff like this. This is a roll of 2-inch GP9 tape. Opening it up, you get a sheet, the location on the tape where all the songs start and end, and this reel of magnetized tape. You know, it's 2 inches. This thing can hold 16 to 24 tracks. You need to add an extra inch if you want 32, but even then 32 was very rare back in the day. The other problem with recording this way is not only can this decompose, but you can also only get about 35 minutes or 30 minutes even of audio on this, depending on how fast you run the actual machine itself. This method of recording is pretty primitive by our standards these days, but what does this mean for you, the person who's just trying to get into recording drums? Do you need to record on tape? Well, no, but put yourself in the shoes of an engineer in the 70s for a minute. Because of the medium, you're looking for the minimum viable mic setup to get this album recorded in a way that's gonna sound good. This means using as few mics as you possibly can to get the best sound, and bouncing submixes, which means you take all mics you use on the drums, bounce it down to 2 tracks, and then that makes room for other things like horn sections, string sections, backup vocals, and all the other lovely stuff that 70s music is known for. Again, all bounced down to 2 tracks to save as much space as possible. What this means for the modern engineer is that you don't actually need to spend that much money to get a sound that has worked perfectly fine on multi-platinum albums. And while it is a bit more upfront expensive than a 4-input interface in a Glyn John setup, it's actually the most cost-effective, you know, sort of most out for least in solution that you can get with modern drum recording. Additionally, recording drums in this way lays very strong groundwork for recording other more production-heavy styles like heavy metal, where the drums need to be big and bombastic. You know, the tricks you'll learn here with mic placement and, you know, getting the sound at the source will be incredibly useful for you going forward. And that is the one phrase you'll hear me saying all the time throughout this series: at the source. You can't put back what was never there. So, how do we get a 70s drum sound? Well, first, get your tools together. You'll need a drum set, a good drummer, a dead room or some way to deaden the space you're already in, some packing blankets and flannels, an interface with 8 XLR inputs, a stereo bar, a drum key, some old drum heads, and a Stanley knife. And obviously the requisite 8 mics, mic stands or clips, laptop, door, etc. You know, the common sense stuff. Now, let's see a session in action. So we're down here at the kick drum, and the first thing you'll notice is that I've taken off the front head. This is to get a much more punchy and attack-heavy sound than we would have with a head on the front of the drum. Now, it's quite counterintuitive, actually, because when I record metal and something that needs a very clicky kick drum, I'll put the head on the drum so that I can attain a bit of natural compression. But for this application, we want the head off, but then we're going to deaden the ever-loving crap out of it. As we can see, we've got a packing blanket here, which is sloped up and rest on the batter head just below the midline. We also have a towel under that that's been rolled up and put in a U shape along the bottom of the drum. The sound you're hearing now is the front attack mic. That is a AKG D112 put about 6 inches away from where the beater hits the head. And you'll hear that while it's punchy, it's not quite clicky. And there's also not a whole lot of low end either. That's where this mic comes in. This is the second mic, Neumann TLM-103, that we are adding in now. When processing it, we normally tend to high pass it and then boost the bass so that we can cut out all the noise from these wonderful cymbals and snare and all that stuff. It also gets picked up, but also so that we can get that meat and that thump that you would come to expect from a kick drum. So, one thing that I realized that I've neglected to mention is the drums themselves. This is a Mapex kit, Mapex Saturn series, quite an old one actually, it's about 10 years old. But, you know, I'm not quite sure of the ply. It's a maple drum set. The snare you see is a Tama SLP Bubinga snare. We'll come to how we record and treat that in a minute. And the left side floor tom is a PDP. All maple, again, except for the snare. The cymbals are all Piesty, because Piesty is the best cymbal brand. Don't at me. Actually, yes, do at me. Let's throw some mics up and compare. Now, coming up from the kick drum, we have the top of the kit. Most importantly, the overheads. Now, these are Neumann TLM-102s. Really lovely little mics, and they are done in an XY pattern on a stereo bar, you see? Now, the reason we want to use XY primarily for 70s style recordings is because we want a relatively narrow stereo spread, especially when everything, or almost everything, is being panned out to the extreme side. So the less space we can take up with this, the better. And this is placed across the true center line of the kit, which is a line that keeps the kick drum, the snare drum, and the ride cymbal all on one side, all in the same sort of step field that the microphones can pick up. The dead center here is not particularly great to place mics around, but it is possible and you can do it. So, now let's move on to close mics, and we'll start here with a rack tom. Now, this rack tom, we're only single micing the rack toms. We're using MD421s, very time period accurate microphone. We're using another one on that one. Now, we don't have a third here, so on that floor tom over there is an Audix D4, great little hypercardioid mic. And on the snare, we have the venerable 57, again, pretty accurate. Cymbals, pretty dark sounding cymbals. We've got a Piesty 16 inch full crash and a 19 inch full crash, both of which have been through a lot of sessions. This Piesty 20 Masters Dark Ride, and we've got a 2002 China and a 2002 Sound Edge 14 inch hi-hat. Okay, so now we are back behind the kit, and we can see the shadow of the packing blanket on the kick drum bat head, but we can also see that we're hitting the kick drum primarily with a felt beater. Gives it a much rounder tone than the plastic ones, which we would generally use for metal. The other thing to note are the gobos, which we've got here. Now, the gobos deaden the environment considerably, and will cut out a lot of the room reflections that you have. Now, the reason that 70s drums sound so dead
is not only because they are recorded in a dead environment, but because they loved deadening materials. Like this. This is an old drum head, which I cut up with the Stanley knife, which I mentioned before. You take old drum heads off the drums, cut them up with Stanley knives, put them on the drums. This will considerably deaden down the sound. And in this one, we still were getting a bit of ring, so we duct taped a flannel to that. The flannel just jumps up and goes back down with the hit of a drum. Yes, that's how we speak, Jake. Very good. Now, in terms of sticks, I particularly like these JoJo Mayer signature sticks. As you can tell, they've seen quite a few wars, as it were. But you want to generally stay away from nylon tips. They weren't very popular in the 70s and weren't exactly favored within the genre. Now, we head over here. We've got our interface. Everything is running into here. The only eight main mics are all running into this Scarlett 18i20. The two extra ones, 9 and 10, the second floor tom and the room mic, are running into the extra preamps on the Focusrite Dynamic Octopre. And finally, we're here with an Austin ribbon mic. This is a room mic, but we've got the null spot pointed towards the drums. We are trying to capture the reflections off the walls of either side of the studio. It's in a shock mount because this is rather susceptible to mechanical noise, but otherwise, very solid microphone. Let's hear how it all sounds. Okay, everyone, we're here. It's the final day of sessions with this 70s drum sound. Just had a lot of content ideas recently with this sound in mind, so we kept the drum set up for the entire period it would take to film all of this stuff. So I thought it would be a great idea to show you guys exactly how we do things here. What you're going to see is me playing on a session. You know, we have... That was remarkably smooth of me, wasn't it? Let's bang into the mic stand. We have a couple of things to film. We have a Instagram cover, a full band cover of the same song, which will probably be a bunch of picture-in-picture of me playing the parts of the song. Hey, I might even sing. Who knows? I don't. Future me does, though. So, we'll see how it goes. So what you're about to see is me tuning up the drums, getting the final checks done, listening to what we have to do today, making a chart, and then sitting down and just going for it. So hope you enjoy.
A dark suit, come around here, 14 carats on his lavalier, a two-tone leather, tie up his toes and a pocket.
Now, something that's interesting to note here, because this is just for me and my channel, I do the charts when I'm in the room, but if I'm working for another client and I'm doing session drumming for them, you know, it's best practice for all of you aspiring session drummers out there to have that stuff done as early in the process as possible. Like, learn the song first, then go in the studio. Don't waste people's time. It's just not a good look. Anyway, let's get to it.
Come over here, sit next to me. We can see what things go naturally. Just say the word and I'll part the sea. Just come over here and sit next to me.
So that's it, another session in the books. We've got all the tracks we need, everything's recorded, and you've heard how it sounds when it is mixed. And we're now 3 for 3 on shirts in this video, so that's good. So let's recap and go over what we've learned, hopefully, or what rather I hope you've learned, through watching this video. We've seen how and why to be efficient with our mic choices. And we've also seen how best to prepare the drums to record and get this sound, and how to get the sound at the source. We've also seen what kind of environment we need to record the drums in. So hopefully, with that said, you know that recording drums has a lot of factors. It's how the drums sound at the source, the room that the drums recorded in, and what mics and mic choices that you make, and also how the mics are placed too. We've
seen how to point close mics for the best sound. We point it at where the drummer hits the drum. And we've also seen how to get a regular, sort of very honest stereo image of the drum set and not one that's larger than life. Larger than life we'll get to, but helps to have a tee to hit off at first. We've also seen how to make multiple microphones on the same drum work together and why it's a good idea, and how to make them play nice with all the other kit elements. And finally, we've got some good advice for drummers to play this style. If you've only ever played heavy metal and blast beats like I had before I learned about my love for this style, you know, it's pretty damn hard. Don't worry, the drum recording series is coming up. Bear with me. So now, as the final point in this video, I want to look at a way that we can get this sound quality on a budget. So for this part, I'm going to make four assumptions. First, that you have a drummer with a drum kit that is in good working order and who can foot the bill for heads himself. Two, that you already have some kind of DAW laptop setup with some basic plugins, like, even doesn't even have to be paid, just like free plugins with like Reaper or Pro Tools or Logic or anything that you have. Third, that you have some kind of good headphones or monitors. Monitors are definitely better if you can swing it, but headphones will work in a pinch. I actually mixed this mostly on my Sennheiser HD650s because I was at my apartment and not at the studio, so that's fun. And finally, you have access to some kind of heavy packing blanket or curtain and a relatively dead room like a closet or some kind of modified bedroom. So when thinking about how best to do this, I had a number of factors that I had to consider, but I really only came up to just a few very basic things that were real make or break for this stuff. The first one, quality of sound. You gotta have a mic that sounds good. Second, you gotta have a robust mic. You've got to have something that can take a beating and what will last you a while. And third, quality of investment. Now, this is a little bit different, you know, than just sturdiness of the mic. For instance, I'm going to mention a mic, the Studio Projects B3, but there's also a Studio Projects B1, which is cheaper. But the B3 not only sounds a little bit better, but also has multiple polar patterns. So you can use it for many, many different applications down the road on your audio journey, as it were, than just a kick drum out mic. So it's a better investment in the long term for what you're gonna do. So with all that stuff in mind, here's how to get a similar sound to what I just got on a budget of under $2,000. All right, guys, I've got my list right here. Let's have a look, shall we? So we got a 10 pack of mic cables for $42, not too bad. And Focusrite Scarlett 18920 for $500. The Lewitt DTP340, we need two of those. Those are for Tom mics, Rack Tom and Floor Tom. That'll cost you $198 at $99 each. SM57 for the snare, that's $99. The Lewitt LCT140 Air, you need three of those at $447. This is for two overheads and a snare bottom mic. The Studio Projects B3 for a kick drum out mic, but of course we've got all the extra polar patterns and all that lovely good stuff, so we can use it for vocals, guitar, room, on drums or really on a whole band. Anything, really. The AKG D112, standard kick drum mic, that's $199. The Audix D-Vice gooseneck mic clip, these are to clip your tom mics to your tom so you don't have to splurge on extra stands. Those are $58 for two of them. You'll need four Samson short boom stands for kick drum and snare drum mics. Two for kick in and kick out, two for snare top and snare bottom. That will run you $92. A tall boom mic stand at $29. I would recommend, a more expensive mic stand would be better because it will wear out less frequently, and of course you've got a rather heavy apparatus on it. But I thought if you're gonna be recording drums and you need to do it quickly, the $29 one from Guitar Center will be just fine. And finally, a stereo bar for $20. That's to get that XY spacing. Total cost, $1,843 and change. You can get this down even further by borrowing from friends, buying used, and doing like online coupon clipping for most of the stuff. Like I said before, it's a bit more expensive upfront than just a four input interface with four mics and a drum kit and door and stuff, but you will actually be getting the best sound quality possible for the money that you've put in. If you want to go really hardcore, you could get your hands on a PA mixer and a two input interface, which most of you seem to have, but you'd need to borrow like an eight channel PA
mixing board, and you would plug all the drum mics into that and then take the stereo output of that and put it into the two-channel line level input. This would mean you would need to get your mix exactly how you want it on the board before it ever hits the door, because after that, you won't be able to change the mix. Although this would get you amazing at mixing very fast and amazing at getting the sound of the drums at the source. You could still edit digitally with comping and Beat Detective and Elastic Audio and all that stuff, but by and large, you're kind of stuck with what you have, and that's both a blessing and a curse. Whichever way you decide to go though, you'll have the gear required to get a sound that has worked perfectly well on multi-platinum albums around the world. Everything else, after that point, it's up to your engineering ability, the quality of the song, and the skill of your drummer. So, I hope you've got something good out of this. Please like, comment, subscribe, and ring the bell for new videos. I'm trying to put out a video once every month. Hopefully that will go up as these videos get more popular. So, please do all of the good YouTube-y algorithm things, and let me know in the comments what topics you would like to see covered next. So, without further ado, let's get you making music.